time once again for Community Forum, and we are very lucky to have with us live in the studios this morning Representative Gerry Pollet. Representative Gerry Pollet is state representative for the 46th District. He is the founder and executive director of Heart of America Northwest, a region-wide citizens group dedicated to the cleanup of the Hanford Nuclear Reservation. For more than 10 years, he chaired the committee of the U.S. Department of Energy's Hanford Advisory Board. He teaches at the University of Washington School of Public Health and also runs an internship program for law students and undergraduate service leaders at the University of Washington. And he is here to update us on cleanup at the Hanford Nuclear Reservation and recently revealed radioactive contamination at Manguson Park in Seattle. Gerry, thank you very much for coming in and spending time with us again this morning.
That's great to be able to talk with you this morning about these important issues, especially Manguson Park, which is the hidden radioactive waste dump right here in the heart of Seattle.
So talk about that and talk about the situation at Manguson Park and how you initially heard about it.
So this is a story of a real cover-up by government agencies. In 2010, the Navy, which used to own Manguson Park as the Sandpoint Naval Air Station, and the Seattle Parks Department discovered that there were very high levels of radioactive contamination in the soil and a couple of the buildings around Manguson Park at the north end of the park for people who use the park. And the Navy did a survey, a very detailed radiological survey that found extremely radioactive areas in the soil. And then the Seattle Parks Department and the Navy did nothing about it and refused to inform anyone. They essentially kept it a secret for 3 years until March of 2013, when it just ironically that someone who happens to spend their day job working on the cleanup of radioactive contamination at Hanford represents Northeast Seattle in Olympia. And the Navy's idea of public involvement is to call three or four elected leaders and say, we're doing a great job, we've begun a cleanup in your district. And they didn't even tell elected leaders what it was they were cleaning up, but because of my work, I wanted to know. And then they started by saying, it's nothing to worry about, we're cleaning up a little bit of what, and I'm going to put this in air quotes, low-level radioactivity. And I said, radioactivity? We need to know more. And it turns out that it's not low-level at all. In fact, and this is what's so shocking, an area that was open to the public for 3 years without a fence around it, the radiation level, if a child had just sat on the ground all year long, they would have received 1,200 full-body x-rays. Now, that's an astonishing level of radiation. That's the type of radioactivity we see at some of the most contaminated areas in Hanford. So we're talking about someone who, if they were exposed to that year-round for many years at 8 hours a day, they'd be expected to grow up and have a 100% fatal cancer incidence. And this was kept a secret, Mike.
So how do they get away with then calling that low-level radiation?
Well, they lie. I mean, there's no two ways about it. It is not low-level radiation. It is not legally high-level nuclear waste, which is only waste from a nuclear reactor's spent fuel, but it is not a low level of radiation. I went the very first public discussion of this at the Manguson Park Advisory Committee. I attended, and the Navy spokesperson held up a sheet of paper and said, this is such a low level of radiation from the radium in the soil that this piece of paper can stop it. Unfortunately for her, I was there and know something, and anyone actually, though, can just look up on Wikipedia radium and see that it is a gamma emitter, and the gamma rays are the things that penetrate through feet of soil or through feet of lead shielding in concrete. And it was just a downright lie to say that radium will only emit alpha particles that can be stopped by a piece of paper. So she basically was trying to get away with something that the Navy knew was a lie, and it wasn't until we organized and pushed to have a public meeting in May of 2013 about this, that the week before, the Friday before the public meeting, the Navy went out and put up fences around the contaminated areas because Heart of America Northwest, other neighborhood groups, and myself were talking to the press about the fact that the areas with radiation were not even fenced off and there were no notices put up about it.
So what was the source of the radioactive contamination?
The Navy says that the source of the contamination, the radium, is from painting dials on old aircraft so that they would glow in the dark. And a little bit of radium can be very radioactive, and they had machine shops were in the buildings, and the buildings we're talking about include a building attached to what is now Arena Sports, a building number two at Manguson Park, a hangar that is called Building 2, which used to be the indoor sports arena, and some of the other machine shops, etc. And so they painted the dials, and the radium was essentially disposed down the storm drains, contaminated the storm drains that lead right out into Lake Washington. Somehow it got out into the soil far from some of the buildings. The Navy's excuse is, well, someone would stand on the roof and pitch buckets of water that were contaminated with radium out into the dirt, but they'd have to be Superman to have gotten the contamination 50 yards away. And that's not how it got there, and we don't really know how it got there. And then even more disturbing, there's also two other types of contamination, including cesium, which is extremely radioactive, very high dose rates, a metal. And there, we, Heart of America Northwest, and I have submitted Freedom of Information Act requests to the Navy asking how they used cesium, where they used it, and how they disposed of it at Manguson Park. And for 2 years, the Navy has refused to disclose those documents. Their excuse is that instead of giving them for free, they're saying you'll have to pay thousands of dollars with no limit on a search for the records. They ought to be available for anyone to see so that we know where the cesium might be and how we have to clean it up. And it's a disgrace that the City of Seattle, the Parks Department, and the State Department of Ecology aren't requiring the Navy to post those records online for anyone to see.
And I believe, is it strontium that was the other?
Strontium 90 is the other element, and the Navy says that was used in the 50s as a replacement for radium paint, which is probably true, but again, we'd like to know where they used it and where they disposed of it. At other Navy bases, including two in California, one very well-known, Treasure Island in San Francisco Bay, at the same time the Navy turned Sand Point under federal law over to the City of Seattle for both a park and public housing purposes, the Navy turned Treasure Island over to the public there, and only in the last couple of years was it disclosed that there was cesium scattered throughout the front yards, the gardens, even under the housing units that had been turned over to the public. And the state of California has stepped in and forced the Navy to dig up those yards and clean it up to a degree that we would be, we hope we could force the Navy to do here at Manguson Park. There are over 400 people who live in housing in the park, and the Navy refuses to consider them in their cleanup plan. And what do I mean by that? Well, do you believe that someone only uses a park like Manguson Park, which is the regional magnet for recreation? It is the most used park in terms of it has summer camps, it has a high school located in it now, it has sailing, it has beaches, it has soccer fields, it has other fields, it has a tennis center. Literally, my kids spent every summer day there at one of the day camps where you're tromping through the woods and the wetlands and playing in the dirt. And there are 400 residents who live there full time. So the Navy says, we're only going to clean up to a level that is safe if you use the park just 2 hours a day, 5 days a week. That's an astonishing social injustice to the people who live there. It's an environmental justice issue. And of course, it is a direct risk to thousands of children who use the park every year for far more than 2 hours a day, 5 days a week. This is the exposure scenario. And at that rate, they say it would be safe. And what they call safe is a radiation level that for an adult male like myself, 8 out of 10,000 adult males there 2 hours a day, 5 days a week, would get a fatal cancer. Our children are 3 to 10 times more susceptible to cancer than adults are. So you're talking about a very high level of risk from just 2 hours a day, 5 days a week. And that's what the Navy says is its cleanup level. And here's what really upsets me and a lot of the community in Northeast Seattle. Seattle Parks Department refuses to just step in and say to the Navy, you have to clean up to a level that is safe for someone to live in this park and to use the park, you know, 10 hours a day, year round. That's what we need to be aiming for. That's what's being required of Navy properties in California and other locations around the country, not 2 hours a day. It's just a joke when, you know, they admit that it's 2 hours a day, 5 days a week is their level of what's safe.
Aren't the standards for at the Hanford Nuclear Reservation higher than that?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that. Yeah, we've been pointing this out that, you know, for cleaning up Hanford, which is not a public park, right? EPA requires the cleanup to be more rigorous than is being proposed for our public park where 400 people already live at Manguson Park. So the EPA has a radiation cleanup level that is 20% more protective after someone is exposed essentially 12 hours a day living on the site. So it is probably 10 times more protective than what is being proposed for Manguson Park. And, you know, we've provided the city of Seattle, and of course the Navy knows this, so we've provided all the documentation to the city of Seattle and the State Department of Ecology, and I think they're just afraid to, you know, stand up to the U.S. Navy. In California and San Francisco, the local and state governments have had the backbone to stand up to the U.S. Navy and force them to clean up properly.
And isn't the city looking at bringing in another 200 residents into the park soon?
Right. In fact, Speaker of the House Frank Chop and I have been working on getting the state funding to convert the biggest unused housing building from the Navy at Manguson Park into affordable workforce housing for families, which is desperately needed in Seattle, and especially Northeast Seattle, where we're mostly building just one-bedroom apartments and studios. And so we hope to be able to convert this into over 150 affordable workforce family housing units. It's a huge building, Building 9, and it's a beautiful building, long 2.5-3-story building, colonial style brick, and it's part of the historic district, and it's been sitting there unused and going to waste for over 20 years, and it's time to turn it into housing. And we need to make sure that the residents are going to be safe. I do want to say this. We met with Mayor Ed Murray earlier this week, and because the Navy is refusing to do this radiological survey around the residences, Mayor Murray told me that he was going to make sure that the city did it if the Navy didn't do it, which is a real victory for us, and I really appreciate the mayor understanding the environmental justice issue involved with low-income residents having been ignored who live right there. But we have to force the Navy to pay for this.
So when this was, obviously when it was discovered, it doesn't appear to have happened, but once it was revealed to the public and you, of this contamination, did they do a site-wide study and or inventory of the park?
So, unfortunately, the Navy refused to do more than one small area. It's a pretty large area, I should say, on the north end of the park around the Building 2 and Building 27 hangars. And I've been contacted by whistleblowers who worked for the Navy doing that radiological survey, and they were told that they couldn't cross the chain link fence, for instance, where their contamination obviously didn't stop at the chain link fence going on to the NOAA property. And they were told not to go further south towards the housing. So we have a good radiological survey only of the very north end of the park near buildings 2 and 27.
And as we have seen at the Hanford Nuclear Reservation, obviously radioactive contamination moves on its own.
It does. And, you know, we've even seen without any planning or anything in the last year, while they're supposed to be cleaning up, we've seen right near adjacent areas where, you know, right next to the fences, essentially, on the other side of the fence, contractors digging up soil to put in utility lines where the Navy records show that there is likely to be contamination, and the utility line excavators had no information about that. They dug it up. That soil might be anywhere now, or, you know, it, and it certainly spread in mud ponds. I mean, I took pictures of it on March 30th of this year where the rain had basically filled the excavation hall and water was with mud was flowing out of it and across the parking lot, etc. And there was no monitoring whatsoever.
What's your understanding of how large the naval facility was prior to it becoming a park? Did it pretty much encompass all the land that we now use as a park?
Yes. And one of the more interesting things is we think of the area where the housing was as, you know, well, they wouldn't have disposed of waste where the housing was. But the housing was built more recently in the history of Sandpoint Naval Air Station. And it is quite possible that the Navy dumped wastes there and had landfills in that area. Most of their waste they carted off to city landfill, at least starting after World War II. But we don't know. They were painting radium dials in the 30s and 40s there as well. And we don't know where they disposed of those wastes. I mean, obviously, we know the Navy's own theory is that they simply dumped it out the back 40. Well, that leads you to believe that you need to look all over the base to see where wastes may have been disposed.
So what is the Navy's responsibility in this? My impression is that a lot of former military bases that they get away with quite a bit once they leave the area.
They do, as we're seeing. They try to get away with bloody murder. And however, federal law is very clear. The Navy is legally required to return to any site and clean it up or pay for the cleanup. And they have to meet all EPA and state standards for cleanup. They can't just do it to their own level under federal law. And federal law also says that the deed, when they turn the property over to the city, had to contain a covenant that the Navy would return and pay for cleaning up the contamination. And indeed, no pun intended, the deed for Manguson Park to the city includes that covenant, which is why we want Seattle Parks to insist that they disclose the documents and pay for cleaning up, pay for the survey, and don't just stop at 2 hours a day, 5 days a week as a cleanup level. Instead, clean it up so it's truly safe for people to use. That also includes making sure that we find out what went into Lake Washington out those contaminated storm drain lines, which the Navy has yet to do, and finding out whether or not the groundwater that flows into Lake Washington is contaminated. Groundwater is just a few feet below the surface at Sand Point, which sticks right out into Lake Washington at the foot of View Ridge. So the water flows out into the lake, and it's just a couple feet down, and it's very close to the contamination layer. So we would expect to see radium and possibly cesium contamination moving into the groundwater. And in fact, it probably has been moving into the groundwater for 50 years. And we need to have that, you know, monitored. And the cleanup level means that you would dig up the contamination to protect the groundwater as well as someone at the surface.
So the two regulatory bodies or organizations that should be going to bat for the citizens on this are the Seattle Parks Department and Washington State Department of Ecology?
That's right. And ecology says, well, we don't know what our authority is, but you know, we keep pointing, here's the law, it's very clear. And secondly, just take a clue from what the state of California is doing. If the state of California can do it, you can do it. So let's do it. Last legislative session, when this was just getting underway, working with my colleagues, I offered an amendment to the budget to give Ecology $250,000 to supervise the cleanup and involve the public. And Ecology lobbied against it and said, we don't need that money to do this. Now they are saying, we have no money and no authority to do anything, and we don't have any money, so we can't do an advisory committee, for instance, unless the city does it. We can't survey for radioactivity. We have no money to do anything. After they basically urged me to withdraw an amendment that would have given them the money specifically, because they said, oh, there's no problem, we don't need it, we've got the money. So I'm very disappointed in our Department of Ecology.
All right. Well, we got about 5 minutes left. Is okay if we move over to update about Hanford? Speaking of the Department of Ecology.
Yeah, let's talk about the nuclear waste dump everyone does know about.
So the state and Department of Energy reached an agreement in terms of taking care of the double-shelled tanks recently. Can you talk about that?
So there are two types of huge radioactive waste tanks underground at Hanford with liquid high-level nuclear wastes. And it is literally the most deadly stuff ever created on the planet. It's a witch's brew of chemicals and high-level radioactivity. Some of it, we call it liquid high-level nuclear waste, but a lot of it is sludge in these tanks that are the size of four-story apartment buildings covering an entire block. And one of the newer double shell tanks that was built in the 70s, into which they're supposed to be pumping waste from the oldest single shell tanks that are leaking, one of the newer double shell tanks was admitted to be leaking in 2012. So for 2 years, the Department of Ecology has been fighting with the U.S. Department of Energy, saying you must empty the leaking double shell tank and do it now. And the Department of Ecology had stepped up and issued an enforceable order saying, as of September 2014, 2 months ago, you have to have started emptying this leaking double-shell tank. Instead, the Department of Energy refused to do it, didn't even ask for money to do it, and they recently struck an agreement saying that the Department of Energy has until 2016 to begin emptying the tank. So the Department of Energy had said, we'd like to take 5 years to begin emptying it. They split the baby in half and reached an legal agreement that the Department of Energy will start emptying the tank in 2 years. I don't think that splitting the baby in half is an appropriate solution when you're talking about leaking high-level nuclear waste. It's supposed to happen now. Just as disturbing, though, and perhaps more disturbing, is the fact that there is also at least one and possibly six of the older single-shell tanks that are leaking this minute as we sit here. And those tanks are under no order from the Department of Ecology to be emptied immediately. And we've, Heart of America Northwest is very concerned about the fact that all the attention has been paid to the leaking double-shell tank, and the one that is leaking directly into the soil and a very immediate threat is gotten no attention from the Department of Ecology and no order to empty that tank. And this is despite the fact that both federal and state laws say that when you have a leaking waste tank, you have to start emptying it immediately. And that's what the law says, immediately, because it's grave danger if it's just leaking into the soil. And no one's taking any action about the leaking single-shell tanks. So we're putting pressure on, and we're urging that there be public meetings held around the region about the agreements about what to do with the tank waste and the dispute between the Department of Ecology and Department of Energy. It's in the state's interest, of course, to hold public meetings, and it's not in the U.S. Department of Energy's interest. And we keep saying to the Department of Ecology, well, just because the Department of Energy doesn't want to do public meetings, work with citizen groups and hold public meetings. And only through public pressure will we get the Department of Energy to do the right thing here. And that includes probably going to court.
Is there any chance the Governor Inslee would step in on this and make some waves?
Well, we've been pressing Governor Inslee, and I have to say Governor Inslee really stepped up on the double shell tank and issued an enforceable order, as we were urging him to do, before they gave them 2 more years. And we were really pleased when the Department of Ecology under Governor Inslee said, you have to start emptying the tank in September 2014. The governor also changed state policy to say that the Energy Department has to begin building new tanks to store this waste, because the Department of Energy has been building a treatment plant that people have heard about called the vitrification plant that is just a decade or two behind schedule and just about, you know, $12 billion, that's $12 billion with a B, dollars over budget. And it's been the subject of numerous whistleblower complaints and a lot of news coverage over the fact that they started building the plant without knowing if the chemical process would be workable or safe, and it's not either one. So they don't have a treatment plant, so they need new double-shell tanks to put the waste in from the leaking single-shell tanks, and the governor has said you have to build those tanks. And that's one of the things that we think that there should be public meetings about, so members of Congress learn about it, and they help us force the Energy Department to pay for it.
All right. Well, unfortunately with that, we are out of time. We're talking with Gerry Pollet. He is state representative for the 46th District and executive director of Heart of America Northwest. And what is your website?
I was going to say, Mike, we need to tell people how they can get more information and get in contact with us. And for both Magnuson Park and Hanford issues, please go to hanfordcleanup.org. hanfordcleanup.org. There's a page with Magnuson Park information. There's also on our Heart of America Northwest Facebook page, there's links for a petition to the mayor and Department of Ecology for creating an advisory committee for Magnuson Park. And of course, lots of information about Hanford on website.
All right. Well, I want to thank you very much for coming in and spending time with us again this morning.
Thanks, Mike.